moving in one direction. To what? To the next one. The next one, the next soma, the next cell body. And here it shows you how impulses can move from one to another. And this is the way impulses move up to reach the brain. CNS is composed of thousands to millions neuronal pools. What is a neuronal pool? Neuronal pool is a collection of neurons. This is a neuronal pool. See, cell body, soma, 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 and so on, and these are the dendrites, and this is the junction with the next one, and this one is the axon. So, incoming signals enter the neurons through synapses located on neuronal dendrites and cell body. Conversely, output signals travel through the axon, leaving the neuron. Axon has many separate branches to other parts. So if you return again, these are now, if you look at that one, again, it comes out through this one, the axon. Signals normally passes in a forward direction from the axon of a preceding neuron to dendrites of the subsequent one. Nociceptors, afferent nerve fibers, مستقبلات الألم. Nociceptors free non-encapsulated pain receptive nerve endings found in every structure of the body. Pain is not produced by direct stimulation of these nociceptors. How pain is then produced? You don't have or you don't need only to irritate or injure the nociceptor for pain to take place. No, pain needs to injure the tissue around. And some chemicals are being released. These are the ones that stimulate the nociceptors. So now what we have is noxious agent causing injury to the tissue surrounding receptors, endogenous algesic chemicals are being released. And these endogenous algesic chemicals that you see trigger the nociceptive activity, generate afferent nerve impulses transmitted through the A delta and C fibers. Endogenous algesic chemicals such as we have bradykinin, serotonin, histamine, prostaglandin, and the potassium chloride. All are detected around the blood vessels in the area that is being injured and around the nociceptors. Nociceptors are labeled by the type of associated afferent nerves. We have thermoreceptors for temperature, receiving temperature, mechanoreceptors receiving mechanical stimuli, chemoreceptors for chemical stimuli, and polymodal, which have multiple stimuli to take care of. Now, peripheral nervous system, all these neurons are 10 primary afferent fibers. Primary afferent fibers are divided into A beta fibers, transmit light, touch, and proprioception. A delta and C fibers encoding pain. Vast majority of delta nerves are C fibers, and C fibers innervate the central pulp and terminate beneath the odontic plastic layer. So now what we have here? We have larger fibers, A alpha and A beta fibers. Intermediate, which are A gamma, and small, which are A delta. Of course, the C fibers are even this small, or the smallest. Fibers having the largest diameter are classed A fibers. Fibers having the smallest diameter are classed C fibers. Fibers with intermediate size are classed B fibers. Now, let us look at each one, which kind of these fibers that are working in our dental field. A alpha fibers, motor and proprioceptors. Conductivity from 70 to 120 meters per second. Diameter from 12 to 20 micrometer and myelinated. These are the largest. A beta fibers, mechanoreceptors. See now, the large ones are mechanoreceptors, receiving mechanical or touch or pressure. Rapidly conductive, 35 to 70 meters per second, myelinated large diameter neurons from 5 to 10 microns and respond to light, touch, and pressure. A gamma fibers control and maintain motor movement of muscle spindles, rapidly conductive for 15 to 30 meters per second, myelinated and large diameter from 3 to 6 microns. Now, look at A beta and A gamma. We call them both pre-pain. They carry pre-pain, which is touch and pressure. Touch and pressure is not a pain, wouldn't cause pain. But if the pressure has been increased or the touch has been cut to a hit, now pain starts. So we call them pre-pain carrying nerves. And then we come to A delta fibers, fast conducting, 12 to 30 meters per second, myelinated, large diameter neuron, 1 from 4 to 5 micron, responsible for ferrous pain. Now we start, we move to the next step, is ferrous pain. Ferrous pain are being received by what? By A delta fibers. Nociceptors, sharp, quick or picking, and some A delta fibers are polymodal, which respond to hot mechanical or cold mechanical temperature. So, A delta fibers at least stimulated without injuring the tissues. Why stimulated without injuring the tissues? Because, again, they still receive something that can increase a little bit more than touch or pressure, but without a wound. So, let us look at the pulp then. Now, here are the A delta nerve. It is in the cervix zone. It moves right away through the cell-free zone, odontoplastic layer, and then pre-dentine, and even it travels some distance into dentine. So myelinated nerves such as A delta reach maximum development and penetration into the pulp when the root apex completes its development. We all know that, we always say that never, if you have an immature or recently erupted tooth, never run the vitality test on it, whether electric or thermal, because it will give you what? It will give you false negative results. False negative results means that the pulp is necrotic. The pulp is not necrotic, of course. But these kind of nerves have not completed its development, have not completed its growth. Complete development with the maturation, complete maturation of the root. That's why we don't rely on these kinds of tests in case of a mature case. So, therefore, thermal and vitality tests are not, reliable on immature teeth. And then we come to C fibers, the most important one to us in the pulp, of course, with the delta, A delta. The only one that's unmyelinated and the smallest. Look at this one, small diameter, 0.5 to 2 micrometer, with lower conduction velocity from 0.5 to 2 meters per second. Responsible for the second pain experience. This is the last one, at last with you. Now, we had the pre-pain, the first pain, and the second pain. Second pain associated with dull aching, throbbing, or prolonged sensation. And C fibers, most of them are polymodal. Slow speed is due to smaller diameter and lack of myelin, which means that speed that through which the impulses move, slower when there is no myelin sheath and when the diameter is small. Unmyelinated C fibers number C to 4 times more than myelinated A fibers. Therefore, C fibers have higher threshold excitability because they predominate. And then we come to this. Not all pain entities presenting as toothache are of odontogenic origin. We have the heterotopic kind of pain. And if you look at somebody having some sinusitis or something, what would he feel? He feels pain. Looks like the pain of pulpitis. In what? In the upper molars, the 6 and 7. It will go misdiagnosed as if this is a case of pulpitis. So this is what we call heterotopic kind of pain. Again, it happens the same way in the temporal mandibular zone. So on the contrary, primary pain, perceived site of pain, is the actual source of pain. When it is pulpitis, it's a primary pain. When it is referred from other areas, it's heterotopic. Nerves to the pulp are supplied primarily by the A delta and C fibers. A delta and C fibers afferent almost exclusively nociceptors, and recently a small number of pulp nerves at large diameter may also transmit other sensations. And then we come to another area. What is the areas, the three areas which we call them the order neurons? We have here three areas. We call them three afferent synapses or three order neurons. Pain impulses are then relayed to post-central gyri of cerebral cortex and become recognized as sensory pain. If you look at this cerebral cortex in here, look at this one, post-central gyrus. Gyrus means in Latin, lafaif of the brain. Post-central gyri, this is the center where everything ends and being explained and being responded to in this area. So let us go on and start with the first order neuron. What is a first order neuron? We have the afferent sensory neurons, Two processes, first was our dendrites originate in the pulp and these terminal receptors extend to the pulp periphery. And cell body located in small lunar ganglion of the fifth cranial nerve. The second process, the axon, proceeds to terminate or synapse in the spinal nucleus of the fifth cranial nerve. Let us see that. Now we're having here the pulp. See this? All of it up to the trigeminal or Cassarian ganglion. This is the dendrite. They start in the center of the pulp periphery and then extend to that area. Here, in this area, now lies the cell body, the soma. And then extends from the soma, we have the axon, down to what the spinal nucleus of the fifth cranial nerve, which lies inside the spinal cord. All of it is called the first order neuron. It is peripheral, completely peripheral. So now this is the first order neuron, and this is how impulses are being moved down to here. And here is the most important part to us, here where they are present. The second order neuron decussates or crosses to other side, carrying impulses to the thalamus, synapsing with the third order neuron. The third order neuron terminates in the cerebral cortex, what we call post-central gyrus. Let us get back again here. Now, this is the second order neuron. It starts here in the spinal cord, decussates, crosses. If it is now in the right side, crosses to the left side and moves right away up to the thalamus. Here, that's the second order neuron. All of it is in the spinal cord. And the third order neuron, all of it is in the brain up to the post-gyrus center. Now, if we look at this one, remember when somebody gets a stroke, what happens? They would say that he got a stroke in the right side. And he goes to the left. All of it happens where? All of it happens in second order neuron. That's why Dicker says in this. So now, after we had this briefing concerning neuroanatomy and neurophysiology, let us move to the pain theories. Now, several theories have been offered to explain pain mechanism. None of them was adequate to answer questions such as, why you may section a nerve and still experience pain? Why normally non-painful stimuli are sometimes excruciatingly painful? Why come horrendous injuries, while some horrendous injuries are not accompanied by pain? 1965, Ronald Metzak and Patrick Wall proposed what we call the gate control theory of pain modulation. What's about gate control theory of pain modulation suggests that the spinal cord contains a neurological gate, as I showed you right away that here, where the first order neuron ends and the second order neuron starts. Gate represent the initial synapse between peripheral neurons and secondary medullary neurons in the substantia gelatinosa, the dorsal horn of the spinal cord and brain stem. This is what I said, that all of it is in the spinal cord. Spinal cord then contains a neurological gate, either blocks pain signals to the brain or allows it to continue on to the brain. So what's the rationale behind that? That physical pain is not a direct result of activation of pain receptor. It's not just you being injured, it's right away and being transmitted and that's it. No, there are three factors playing in this area. Playing with, no, against each other. The normal gate can open and close thereby modulating pain perception. Psychological factors also play a role in pain perception and getting this also influenced by nerve impulses descending or coming down from the brain, what we call cognition, when mentioned the terminology. So now we have stimulation of large diameter fibers inhibits pain transmission, closing the gate. Stimulation of smaller fibers opens.